Good evening, everybody. Good evening and welcome. I'm Paul Burstein. I'm a member of the Jewish Studies faculty and a professor of sociology and political science here. And I would like to welcome you to this second Stroum Lecture of this year. The room is full, which I'm very, very glad to see, but at the same time, it also feels a little bit empty because Althea's not here. I just want to mention three things that in my experience she especially appreciates or appreciated about these lectures. A couple of years ago, when Yael Zerubbabel was the Stroum lecturer, she spoke about memory in part, and she told the story, her career, her work had really been inspired by a book published out of one of the very earliest set of Stroum lecturers, Zakor by Yerushalmi. And there you've got a situation where one generation inspires the next who comes here to inspire us. And that's really, from generation to generation, it was an amazing thing for everybody to see that, and it was an amazing thing for Althea to see that. As to what's going on here this week, I suspect that on Monday, Althea would have appreciated Professor Sarna's calling this the most prestigious Jewish studies lecture series in the country. And I know she would have loved the jokes as well. Now, you already know Professor Sarna from the introduction on Monday and from his lecture, so I will be very brief. I just want to mention a couple of things. I had breakfast with him on Monday, and during the breakfast I learned about 10 different things, from changes in kashrut to the importance of dispensationist Christians to American support for Israel. And I had tried to think about the last time I had learned so many things, not just at breakfast, but before noon, let's say. And I couldn't remember any. I mean, Professor Sarna has a great deal to teach everybody. And I also want to mention what may very well be my all-time favorite article by him, although I don't know that he would think of it as one of his major works. It's an article about this, which many of you probably recognize. It's an article called How Matzah Became Square, Manischewitz and the Development of Machine-Made Matzah in the United States. Now, he takes a very humble, important, but humble object. And as I'm sure many of you know, matzah used to be round, then it was made by hand. And you can still get that, but for the most part it's square and it's made by machine. And the process of moving from one to the other was very complicated. It involved tradition against modernity, it involved controversies among rabbis, of course. It involved attempts by Manischewitz to assure the rabbis that yes, the machine-made matzah would truly be okay. And there are many, many other aspects to this. It really turns into a story about the history of the Jewish people in the United States. It's a wonderful article. There are very, very few people who can take something like this and turn it into a very, very meaningful story about Jews in the United States. Jonathan Sarna is one of the very, very few people who can do that, and it's an honor to have him with us tonight to speak about the reshaping of American Judaism.
Well, thank you, and I see in case I get hungry there. It's really a delight and a very great honor to be back here this evening. I understand that I am competing this evening. You could have watched Lady Gaga on television. I'm particularly honored that you all chose to come out in the rain here. I should have mentioned that I had met both of the Stroums when they were at my university. And of course, Sarna Stroum came from Waltham, Massachusetts, and came here to Seattle. And I sort of come from Waltham to Seattle, so even though neither of the Stroums are here to share the lecture, I do feel a certain kinship and connection having made that identical journey. I'm told there really are only three very important things that came out of Waltham. One, of course, was the famous watches. Two was Brandeis University, and three was Sam Stroum. So I'm really very, very pleased to be here. Now, I began on Monday by observing that among societies and also among individuals, religion has never been static. It has always been characterized by ups and downs. Periods of greater religious fervor, periods of greater interest in culture and worldly pleasure. I was pleased to learn that the American poet James Ball Naylor, who was perhaps the most famous, maybe the most famous ever, citizen of Malta, Ohio, a rather small place, he recognized this in his best-known poem, which is on King David and King Solomon. It reads like this. King David and King Solomon led merry, merry lives with many, many lady friends and many, many wives. But when old age crept over them with many, many qualms, King Solomon wrote the Proverbs and King David wrote the Psalms. So we left off last time, not quite with Psalms, but certainly with an uplifting sense that American Judaism had experienced a wondrous late 19th century revival. Between the late 1870s and World War I, the American Jewish community not only multiplied by something like 12-fold thanks to massive immigration and actually a quite prodigious birth rate, but it also witnessed a plethora of new synagogues, the opening of two important rabbinical seminaries, Jewish Theological Seminary and Rabbi Isaac Elchanan Theological Seminary at Yeshiva University, in addition, of course, to Hebrew Union College, which had opened earlier in 1875. And we also saw in this period a very wide array of Jewish educational initiatives at every level, supplementary schools, summer camps, Jewish Chautauqua Society, the publication of the first English language Jewish encyclopedia, and the opening of numerous Hebrew teachers' colleges, beginning with Gratz College that opened in 1893. And as I mentioned, these Hebrew colleges opened up new Jewish educational opportunities for women, as did the National Council of Jewish Women, founded in 1893, Hadassah, founded in 1912, with a strong educational mission. So it was that in 1913, on the very eve of World War I, upon the occasion of the 25th anniversary of the Jewish Publication Society, American Jewry received an encomium from the Jewish community of England, the mother country. And it's extremely interesting because it really demonstrated how far the American Jewish community had come. We watch with the deepest interest the marvelous strides you have made and are making in this great and glorious land of freedom and independence. The letter from England's Jewish community began. It continued, you care for things of the spirit. You are alive to the intellectual and spiritual side of life. You provide windows for the soul of Israel. There could scarcely be more persuasive testimony to the immense religious and cultural strides that American Jewry had made since that American Jewish awakening had begun back in the late 1870s. But World War I rang down the curtain on this awakening and on these developments. In the war's wake, attention shifted to combat it. Burgeoning anti-Semitism at home. Think of the notorious anti-Semitism spread by Henry Ford. And also attention shifted to helping to relieve the suffering of Jews abroad, particularly in Russia and Poland. The great Jewish philanthropy of the era was the American Jewish Joint Distribution Committee, which aimed to help the suffering of Jews abroad. The earlier age of optimism that saw American Jews deepen their religious commitments and initiate a broad range of cultural projects gave way to what might be called an age of pessimism, characterized by burgeoning concerns over immigration restriction, worldwide anti-Semitism, the perilous financial and political state of European Jewry. By 1920, according to the great American Jewish leader Cyrus Adler, who was disgusted by the new trends that he saw developing, quote, practically every Jewish organization of higher learning or science in America was broke. Just as the post-war era witnessed the decline of the progressive movement and of the Protestant social gospel, so too it witnessed a decline in Jewish religious life. Contemporaries saw what was happening. One Jewish leader writing on the eve of World War I warned that, quote, more than two-thirds of American Jewish children were growing up outside the sphere of any religious influence and guidance. Another expressed alarm that children of immigrants were being de-Judaized. A study issued by the Reform Movement found attendance at temple only half as widespread among younger men as among older men. In 1929, before the great stock market crash, both the Reform and the Conservative rabbinate complained at their conventions that, quote, the synagogue is being invaded by secularism. The proliferation of wealth in the 1920s, an era that saw many American Jewish immigrants rise up into the middle class, resulted in what one speaker at the Conservative Rabbinical Assembly described as babbitry, meaning that too many Jews seem to resemble the lead character in Sinclair Lewis's 1922 novel entitled Babbitt. They had, it was alleged, become narrow-minded, self-satisfied, materialistic go-getters rather than devoted, learned, and spiritual Jews. Justice Horace Stern of the Court of Common Pleas in Pennsylvania later became a Supreme Court justice there and really an esteemed communal leader. He means no words in his evaluation of the declining place of the synagogue in the early 1930s. Quote, religion, at least in its organized forms, has to an appreciable extent lost its hold upon the present generation. He declared, he warned of the gradual retrenchment and shriveling up of our synagogues so far as direct communal activity is concerned, of the loss of interest of the new generation in organized religion, and of a future where synagogues might become, quote, mere theological shelves stripped of their former communal glories, prestige, and dominance. In calling for a wholesale reform of Jewish communal life so as to restore the synagogue to modernity's geographic spread, Jews were beginning to move out from that intense centered communities where most Jews lived near other Jews. And then he went on to complain about competition, quote, from automobiles, golf clubs, radios, bridge parties, extension lectures, and the proceedings of various learned and pseudo-learned societies. Now, today we understand that Jews were actually far from the only group experiencing what historian Robert Handy described as, quote, the American religious depression. From the mid-1920s to the mid-1930s, church attendance dropped markedly in the United States, and Americans of many kinds displayed new interest in universalism, the secular, the so-called cosmopolitan spirit. The widely publicized Stokes trial, the so-called monkey trial in 1925, highlighted growing chasms between religion and science and between fundamentalism and modernism, leading some to believe that they had to choose between one and the other. As American religion polarized, fundamentalists actually gained significant ground, but so too did advocates of science and modernism, many young Jews among them. Meanwhile, mainline Protestantism and mainstream Judaism declined. The growth of universities contributed to the decline of mainstream religious movements. Over 12% of all Americans attended college in 1930, compared to under 2% in 1870. That represents a six-fold percentage increase. We don't have good numbers on the percentage of Jews, but I suspect that the growth among Jews was even greater. Colleges by the mid-1920s were hotbeds of secular ideas. The best and brightest students became excited by communism, socialism, Zionism, and other movements of social change, not by religion. This was especially true of young Jews who, as we have seen throughout these lectures, have always been bellwethers of future trends. Young Jews attended college in very high proportions and were deeply affected by the university's cosmopolitan spirit. The great majority of Jewish youths at the colleges, a Harvard graduate declared in 1926, consider their Jewish birth the real tragedy of their lives. They constantly seek to be taken for Gentiles and endeavor to assimilate as fast as their physiognomy will allow. You remember the Jews who changed their nose to spite their race. A year later, Professor Abram Sacker, then at the University of Illinois and a founder of Hillel, described religion among the college generation as follows. At present, he wrote, the call to a religious service finds the serious student frigidly indifferent. God merely arouses suspicion or bewilderment. Prayers make him restless and leave him unstirred. He repeats words mechanically. His attention attention wanders constantly. Never happens in synagogues today. The Great Depression, of course, further weakened religious institutions. Historic congregations, as well as brand new synagogue centers, found themselves, in historian Beth Wenger's words, with shrinking memberships, expensive facilities, and large deficits. Even the wealthiest synagogues, like Temple Emmanuel in New York, saw its membership plunge by 44% in the 1930s. Jewish religious school enrollments declined almost everywhere. In fact, probably the most ignorant Jewish generation, Jewishly, was that generation of the 1930s. Their parents didn't have money. They removed them from religious schools. It is no wonder that Mordechai Kaplan opened his 1934 classic, Judaism as a Civilization, with a chapter entitled The Present Crisis in Judaism. On the very first page of his preface, he declared that, quote, "It has never been so hard to teach Judaism as it is now. Never did the rising generation so question its value and resent its intrusion into their lives." Now, I recall this crisis of Judaism of the 1920s and 30s because I think it may have substantial relevance to our own day. We too have witnessed a significant recent decline in synagogue memberships and in the conservative reform and reconstructionist movements. As I mentioned, Orthodox figures are very hard to come by. We too know many young people who are frigidly indifferent toward Judaism and whose attention wanders constantly on the rare occasions when they come to synagogue. We too see great changes taking place in American Jewish religious life and are somewhat fearful about the future. Now, the past offers no clear roadmap out of this great religious recession, but looking back, we can learn at least three important lessons from the interwar years experience. First, crisis breeds creativity. It is no accident that one of the most influential books in the history of American Judaism, Mordechai Kaplan's Judaism as a Civilization, appeared during a period of time when American Judaism seemed to be most deeply mired in crisis. It is precisely when we fear for the future that we are open to fresh ideas that promise to reshape the future, in this case, by revitalizing Jewish religious life. The independent Minyan community, Kavanah, right here in Seattle, Chabad, one of the fastest growing and most successful Jewish religious movements of the post-war era, and a host of other experiments across the spectrum of Jewish religious life, bear careful watching. Even if 90% of new Jewish startups fail, the remaining 10% may well reshape 21st century American Judaism. Just as Kaplan's Reconstructionist ideas, Stephen Wise's Jewish Institute of Religion, and Bernard Revel's Yeshiva College, all of them products of that interwar years religious depression, planted seeds that only fully germinated decades later, so too, are scattering seeds. Who knows what the future harvest may yield? Second point, even as formal religion declined during the interwar years, it is important to remember that secular expressions of Judaism took off. Michael Gold's communist-inspired Jews Without Money, Charles Reznikoff's By the Waters of Manhattan, both appeared in 1930. Henry Roth's Call It Sleep, one of the great novels of the 20th century, appeared in 1934. Clifford Odets' Awake and Sing, a depiction of Jews in the Depression, published in 1935. Meyer Levin's The Old Bunch, 1937. Delmore Schwartz's fabulous story, In Dreams Begin Responsibilities, in 1938. Through all of these years, the menorah societies promoted Jewish culture of a high order, and memorable Jewish literature in Yiddish and in Hebrew also appeared, as well as important art from leftist Jewish artists like the Sawyer brothers, or Max Weber, or Ben Shahn. Max Weber, he pronounced it, or Ben Shahn. And all of this serves as a reminder that when the practice of Judaism declines, secular Jewish culture can still remain vibrant. And the third point is that the religious depression teaches us to look skeptically upon prophecies of gloom and doom in American Jewish religious life. Such prophecies have accompanied Jews from the very beginning of their sojourn in America in 1654, and sounded particularly persuasive during the religious depression of the interwar years. Many Jews at that time thought they were the last generation of American Judaism. But as in 1825 and in the late 1870s, so in the late 1930s, religious feelings stirred anew. The rise of Nazism seems to have inspired some young Jews to reinvigorate their faith, as if in response to those at home and abroad who labored to undermine it. As early as 1934, Mordechai Kaplan discerned that Jews who had abandoned their people were returning like prodigal sons. Because of the threat of annihilation, he chillingly hypothesized, this was 1934, the Jew was impelled to rise to new heights of spiritual achievement. And indeed, developments that would have surprised anyone in 1930 began to be evidenced. In 1937 alone, three significant Orthodox Jewish all-day schools were founded. Chaylai, the Hebrew Institute of Long Island, Ramaz School in Manhattan, and Maimonides School in Boston. In the early 1940s, both Jewish day schools and Jewish educational camps, like Masad, or what became known as Brandeis Bardeen, and then later Ramah camps, began to proliferate. The great era of Jewish educational camping is really from about 1941, when Masad and Brandeis Bardeen start, to about 1952, when we see the beginning of Reform Jewish camping, what today is called Asrui. Olin Sang, Ruby, Union Institute. The goal of training future Jewish leaders also underlay the Reform Movement's National Federation of Temple Youth, established in 1939, and the Conservative Movement's Leadership Training Fellowship that followed in 1945. And actually, looking at the Jewish Publication Society, which promoted Jewish education and culture through books, we see that its income increased fivefold just between 1935 and 1945. The number of books that it distributed tripled, always a sign of new interest in things Jewish. Indeed, Jewish organizational life as a whole surged in response to Hitler. In 1945, the American Jewish Yearbook reported, quote, a larger number of new organizations formed during the past 5 years than in any previous five-year period. There were 47 new Jewish organizations founded between 1940 and 1945. Interest in Jewish affairs, the yearbook explained, has undoubtedly been heightened as a result of the catastrophe which befell the Jews of Europe under the Nazi onslaught. In short, the religious depression turned out to be a phase in the history of American Judaism. As conditions changed, Judaism revived. The post-war era witnessed a sharp turn back toward religion across the United States, partly as a response to wartime horrors, partly in response to, quote, godless communism. Remember, 1954, we added under God to the Pledge of Allegiance, and everything has been godly ever since. And of course, the return to religion had a lot to do with the baby boom, the post-war baby boom, and even now, the arrival of children often serves as a significant stimulus to church and synagogue membership. Never has religion been so institutionalized, so conspicuous, so public, so journalist Claire Cox concluded in a retrospective 1961 book depicting what she called the new time religion that had taken shape in America since World War II. Never has church going been so acceptable, so much the thing to do. And Judaism played a prominent part in this conspicuous new time religion. As anti-Semitism declined during the post-war decades, the religion of American Jews gained widespread recognition as America's third faith alongside Protestantism and Catholicism. Indeed, there was a very famous book, some of you will remember it, a bestseller in 1955 entitled Protestant Catholic Jew by Will Herberg. Popular interest in Judaism burgeoned in those years as Americans sought to learn more about what was called America's unknown religion of our time. That was Judaism, and in response to the lack of knowledge about Judaism that was perceived, we saw a whole spate of introduction to Judaism books. I think someone recently counted 13 of them published just in a 15-year period. Fueled by post-war economic prosperity, Judaism also strengthened institutionally through the building of new synagogues and religious schools and the development of a whole range of new communal institutions. Now, whether Jews actually became more religious or only affiliated at a higher rate has long been disputed. My distinguished colleague, Professor Stephen Whitfield, has argued that, quote, what was revived was not so much religious belief as belief in the value of religion. Martin Marty and I actually consider the religious revival to have been somewhat more robust. But whatever the case, religion became the major vehicle for Jewish identity, while secular Judaism, the ideology that seemed to be winning out back in the 1930s, secular Judaism in this era largely collapsed as young Jews moved out to the suburbs in the post-war era. They built synagogues. Indeed, it is the greatest synagogue building boom in all of American Jewish history. Well over 1,000 synagogues were built between 1945 and 1965, including some right here in Seattle. And Jews joined synagogues. Affiliation rates reached 60% in the 1950s, a figure never exceeded in the 20th or now in the 21st centuries. And Jews became more interested in Jewish education for their children during these years. The number of children attending Jewish schools more than doubled between 1948 and 1958. Now, there were more children, but clearly more of those children were also attending Jewish schools, usually supplementary schools. And we see greater observance of religious ceremonies at home, particularly Hanukkah and Passover. Judaism has changed, one respondent exulted to researchers in those days. Nowadays, people enjoy religion and going to synagogue, so she reported. As late as 1962, surveys continued to describe, quote, the flourishing state of the American Jewish community's religious bodies. Now, in my view, nothing is so dangerous for American religious movements, and especially for American Judaism, than overconfidence. Once you start being triumphalistic, that's a sure sign decline is coming. Many rabbis, especially in the conservative movement, believed in the late 1950s that they had found a formula that worked. Not only had they revived American Judaism, but they had helped to raise the stature of Judaism in American religion as a whole. They felt secure, proud, confident, and then came the 60s. The civil rights movement, religious ecumenism, opposition to the Vietnam War, the women's movement, the sexual revolution, the spiritual revolution, the drug culture, the counterculture, the Stonewall riots, those are the riots that set off the movement for gay rights, and early stages of the computer revolution, all of them developed or expanded during the 1960s. Those who came of age during that decade rebelled against the authorities of their elders, and they scorned much that the previous generation had valued, and that included scorn poured on the suburban synagogue. Quote, Judaism is rejected because it is seen as part and parcel of the hollow lifestyle, and because it has given young people no help in their search for alternatives to what has become the lifestyle of the Jewish suburb. So it was declared in a manifesto entitled The New Jews. Later, one of the things I'm saying. Disdaining, self-satisfied, rich suburbanites and smug institutions, these young Jews opened a new seminary in 1968 called Chavurat Shalom Seminary. It opened in Cambridge, in Somerville, Massachusetts. Many at the time looked upon the young radical Jews of the 1960s as threatening and dangerous. Hardly the first time that young Jews have confronted such epithets. The American Jewish Yearbook in 1969 actually consigned its discussion of student activism, which was a description of Jews, to its section entitled Patterns of Anti-Semitism. But in retrospect, we know that these young Jews, like so many before them, sought to save Judaism by changing it. They advocated discontinuity as a means of ensuring Jewish continuity. And they did indeed transform the American Judaism of their day. The Chavura movement, through the prayer fellowships that it established and the best-selling three-volume Jewish catalog that its leaders compiled for a time that was the second biggest bestseller in the Jewish world, second only to the Bible. Those Jewish catalogs helped to humanize and personalize Jewish worship and ritual, and they democratized synagogue life. Egalitarianism, informality, cohesive community, active participatory prayer, group discussion. These in time became normative in American Judaism, and even after most of the chavurot, most of those prayer fellowships had either disappeared or evolved into larger and more formal prayer groups or became attached to neighborhood synagogues, their countercultural ideals, their counter-aesthetic values, their relaxed notions of decorum, all of that lived on. Moderated form, they became part of mainstream Judaism, which as a result became, in the following decades and even now, more informal, more focused on promoting fellowship and community among members, more open to discussion-based learning and group singing and participatory prayers. And that really brings us back to where we started on Monday, at the growing sense across the spectrum of Jewish life that something new was happening in the late 1970s, described at the time as a Jewish revival, a reawakening of American Jewish life, a revitalization of Jewish tradition. Synagogues in the 1970s shifted away from universal causes and toward greater emphasis on spiritual and personal growth in Judaism. Once discarded Jewish customs and practices came back into vogue, even in the Reform movement, where the donning of kippot, of yarmulkes, of skull caps, and talitot, prayer shawls, became far more common. Meanwhile, a survey of young conservative Jews found young adults to be more Jewishly active than their older counterparts. Orthodoxy, meanwhile, added thousands of new members who, while not born Orthodox, became known tshuva, penitent or returning Jews, parallel in some respects to born-again Christians in evangelicalism. There was much talk of a shift to the right in Judaism generally and in Orthodox Judaism in particular. More recently, the movement of independent minyanim has looked to revitalize American Jewish life, as articulated by Rabbi Eli Confer, co-founder of Hadar in New York. The goal of the independent minyan movement is to, quote, build a prayer community that speaks to each of its members' spiritual longings, gives participants a sense of community and belonging, and empowers them to find in Judaism a deep sense of meaning and purpose that infuses every corner of their lives. Elsewhere, I have set forth 8 developments that help to shape the independent minyan movement and to some extent the whole Jewish awakening of the past 3 decades. Here I really only have time to list them, but you're familiar with them. The Jewish women's movement, Jewish spirituality, improvements in Jewish education, close ties to Israel, even among members who are deeply critical of its policies. The gay pride movement, with its sense that everyone should be welcome into the Jewish tent. Delayed marriage and childbirth, which has created in our time a whole new stage in Jewish life, the post-college so-called Odyssey years. The era of Jewish life, the Jewish institutions before the independent minyan movement were ill-equipped to serve. The startup culture, with its suspicion of big institutions and its heavy emphasis on sweat equity and technology. And finally, the independent minyan movement greatly benefited from affluence, the availability of philanthropic funding that helped that movement and actually helped Chabad and other recent innovations to grow in ways that might otherwise not have been possible. But for all of the excitement generated by the independent minyan movement, the mood across the spectrum of Jewish religious life today, and especially in the non-Orthodox movements, is disturbingly downbeat. Rabbis see few signs of awakening, many signs of declension. Synagogues across the country are in trouble. Rabbis in their 50s have lost their jobs. Attendance and membership numbers in many synagogues, but not all, are down. Now, what light can history shed on this somewhat difficult moment that we are experiencing in the history of American Judaism? Looking back, we know, I hope, that Judaism in America has never been static. We have traced a series of peaks and valleys, beginning with the American Revolution and continuing with ups and downs through to our own day. These cycles we have seen correlate with trends in American religion generally. For example, the Second Great Awakening. And they respond to challenges, both external and internal. Sometimes, as in the years following the American Revolution, we have seen widespread disappointment with American Judaism, an impatience with its seeming inability to respond to new conditions of life in a new land. on at other times, such as in the late 19th century or in the post-World War II era, what we have seen is that formerly disenchanted young people find in Judaism new spiritual possibilities. They lead the way back to an unexpected Jewish revival, and then hope returns. Too often, we fall into the trap of projecting the future as a straight line forward from the present. If Orthodoxy rises, we imagine that it will ultimately triumph. If synagogues decline, we imagine that they will ultimately disappear altogether. In reality, though, the history of American Judaism has never been linear. Instead, continuity has repeatedly depended upon discontinuity. New historical conditions have created new movements, new emphases, new paradigms, the very opposite of the tried and true. The young, the alienated, those on the periphery of Jewish life have time and again led us in new and unexpected directions. They renew what previous generations rejected and reject what previous generations renewed. Cycles of religion, like economic cycles and seasonal cycles, may frighten and dismay some of us. They strike at our desire for security and stability. They disrupt norms, cause hardship, challenge cherished assumptions, undermine our sense of control. Nevertheless, in my view, we are fortunate to have these cycles within American Judaism, for as we have seen, they promote innovation, creativity, and change. Indeed, throughout our history, cycles of revival and declension have been a prime source of energy within American Judaism, promoting instability, to be sure, but also vitality and new life. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. As on Monday, Professor Sarna is willing to answer questions. He'd be happy to answer questions. If you've got a question, please go. There are microphones on either side, one over there, one over there. So if you have a question, go to the mic, and he'll be glad to respond.
Did you ever see a Jew with another question?
Okay, please, yeah.
It's not my
question.
Okay.
So, apropos our conversation earlier, what I'd like you to do is follow through into the questions that we're now, some of them we're now faced in terms of the conflict over Israel. Where those lines come from in the ideas that you put forth. I mean, I've had Jews come to me and say to me, Israel should never have been created. It's a mistake to have that. And we're having considerable discussions, as you know, both in this country and globally about, you know, who is a Jew and all the rest of that. So could you follow up and cover those two subjects for me?
Well, I think it will require a different set of Stroum lectures to deal with the conflict over Israel and the story of who is a Jew. Neither, I would say, are as new as some people today imagine. The truth is that it was consistently shown that at pretty well any era you look at, young people are less positive towards Israel than older people, which means that Israel is a little bit like your parents. The older you get, the smarter your parents get, and the older you get, you know, the better Israel gets. Now, that doesn't mean nothing has changed, but it's a reminder that we shouldn't necessarily read too much into the current situation. It's also the case that we have not well distinguished between those who are critical of Israel and those who are disengaged. Indeed, some of the people, some of the young Jews most critical of Israel are almost obsessed with Israel. They read about it, they visit it, but they happen to have ties with those who are on the left of the Israeli spectrum rather than those, say, on the right. What's really changed, and I've said this on Monday in response to the question, what's really changed is that once upon a time, you had a wide variety of opinions in Israel, but American Jews pretty well got their news from the JTA, and the policy was we in America follow the government of Israel. With the rise of the internet, that ended. And today, there are so many sources of information about Israel, and the different Israeli news sources, right and left, are available in English as they never were before, so that today the spectrum of views in the United States among Jews on Israel is really a mirror image of the spectrum of views in Israel itself. That is not the same, in my view, as disaffection and disengagement. It's not to deny there is some, but it reminds us that the developments are very different, but as I say, we could use a whole history of the relationship of the American Jewish community and Israel. And if I start going on to a history of who is a Jew, then we'll have to start back in Abraham, and I think it'll be here a long night, so I'll take another question.
Dr. Sarna, with the cyclicity of youth coming back to Judaism over time, under different circumstances, it really begs the question of what is that quality of Judaism that brings people back? What is the resilience of it? Is it really simply just a matter of a need for God, and this happens to be our God, so that's who we go back to? Or do you think there's some other special qualities of Judaism that make it so resilient?
I think in different eras, it has been different qualities. Yes, Jewish education sense, for example, that Jews are ignorant of their religion and need to become better versed in their religion has been a very important claim. But I have a sense that American Jews living in what is really the most religious first world country have, at different times wanted to understand what are the sources of their own religious faith and community, and fearing that they didn't understand it properly, or they didn't understand it at all, they have found deep excitement in returning to that faith. At other times, I think there's a sense that, tried that and it didn't meet our needs. I think in our day, there is a strong sense that among young people, that religion has been a source of great hatred throughout the world. Many of our of our wars across the world are caused by religion, and they have a sense that maybe religion is a source, is the problem rather than the solution. Of course, in the 70s, after an era that promised that science and progress would solve all problems and didn't, there was a sense that maybe religion was the solution and science and progress was the problem. And these cycles have been well known in American life, but I do think that young Jews at different times have had a sense that the richness of Judaism contains within it ideas and movements that may hold the answer to their needs. A good example of that would be the rediscovery in recent decades of the Jewish spiritual tradition and a sense that that held the secret for what young Jews needed and indeed became enormously influential. So in that sense, it's good to have a very long and deep tradition. You can find within it all sorts of answers.
Yeah.
Professor Sarna, thank you for a brilliant lecture and so many new ideas. This is a sub-question of the one that was asked and answered. So it'll be a smaller answer, I'm sure. No, because it's a small question. What do you think are going to be some of the ramifications? I don't know how to get the right height on this. What are some of the ramifications that might come from the fact that so many Jewish texts is now translated and on the internet? So there used to be a hierarchy of scholarship and learning, and now everybody can go through Jewish texts. This has happened only in the last 20 years. Can you talk about that and the American ethos?
So the question is the impact of the fact that so many texts are translated and available. And like so many things, it's the best of times and the worst of times, by which I mean, on the one hand, it has never been so easy to become a Jew well-versed in Jewish texts. Once upon a time, the Talmud was available to a group of Jewish elite men. Today, the Talmud in translation is available to anybody. Men, and one of the great revolutions of our time has been the opening up of Talmudic study to women. And anybody can buy one of several translations of the Talmud and can be a Talmid Chacham, can become deeply learned even if you don't know a word of Hebrew or Aramaic just by studying it in English. So we have greatly democratized Jewish text. What was once the private preserve of scholars has now been open to everyone. However, there are also some downsides. First of all, there is a sense among some people, we don't need to know Hebrew. Everything important is translated into English. And remember that as soon as you are reliant on a translation, that's not the same as being able to deal with the original with all its complexities. One becomes a prisoner of the translator. And everybody who knows anything about a text knows that there is a huge gap between the original and the translation. Think of the many translations of the Bible and what would happen if instead of having access to the Bible in the original, we only had to rely on King James. So there are deep challenges. It is also the case that I think in some circles there's a sense I don't need scholars, I don't need teachers, I don't need this magnificent Jewish studies department. I can study those texts on my own. And the truth is that Jewish texts, like all great texts, are not in all cases things you can just read a master on your own. We do need scholars, we do need teachers, and it's not so simple. But I still consider it a remarkable thing that today anybody can have access to these texts on the internet for free. And given, you know, democracy, this is the democratization of learning. The democratization of learning is like democracy itself. It's the worst system in the world, except for all the others. And you know, that given the choice, I think we will look back at this as a remarkable development that has greatly enriched Jewish life. Yeah.
I'd like to ask, to extend a question that was previously asked and you answered. You mentioned a little bit ago that you felt right now one of the crises is that young people are seeing religion as perhaps the problem rather than the solution. And I understand certainly in Europe there's a great talk about the secularization of Europe. And to some extent there's a similar type of talk going on now. You mentioned in the 60s and into the 70s, the young people came up with this prayer fellowships and community and so forth. What do you see as the challenge today you also mentioned in your last lecture how important leadership was. And that one can discern that in what you said today too. What do you see as the challenges for, say, young people wanting to provide leadership to deal with the crises of today?
So the question is...
and you mentioned the secularism and people who don't feel religion is a problem. So I just wonder if you want to think
about that. Well, I mean, obviously, in any generation, the challenge for Jewish leaders is to discern the great challenges of the times and to strive to meet them, hopefully in creative and successful ways. But since you give me such a nice opportunity, let me say that one of the challenges, I think, for Jewish leaders today is really to come up with a new mission that will inspire young American Jews. The great missions of the 20th century, saving Jews and bringing them to safer country, creating and sustaining a Jewish state, fighting anti-Semitism, remembering the Holocaust, and so on, all of those missions are really behind us. They don't inspire young Jews the way they inspired the previous generation. Previous generation was tremendously excited about freeing Soviet Jews. Well, that's behind us. We have not come up with a new mission that is so powerful as to excite young Jews. Now, and we can see a search for that mission. Now, we've seen a big turn back to social action and social justice in Jewish life, the American Jewish World Service, Chazon, and many of these new organizations. That is certainly part of the tradition. And I would say that some of those organizations are using the interest in social justice as a vehicle for Jewish education. But at the end of the day, there's a great difference between social justice and saving Soviet Jewry. One is inherently a Jewish mission, and the other is not inherently Jewish. You don't have to be Jewish to be in favor of social justice. And indeed, I always call it the Louis Brandeis problem. I have to mention Louis Brandeis once in every lecture. It's in my contract. But Louis Brandeis's daughter brought up in a world where social justice was central, meets and falls in love with the son of the man who wrote the book on the Protestant social gospel named Rauschenbusch. Now, they had much in common. Their values had everything in common. But, you know, the Rauschenbusches, although several generations later still deeply involved in social justice, clearly have no tie anymore to Judaism. We need, that's the problem, that's the challenge of the new turn towards social justice. And what we need really, it seems to me, and maybe this is an answer to the question, Jewish leaders need to formulate a new and compelling mission for young Jews to rally around and become excited about. There's certainly people in this room who have ideas about that, but we need to find one that really works. And I don't think we actually have found it yet. I think we are in search of that kind of unifying mission for the 21st century American Jewish community. But hopefully, 100 years from now, someone will look back and be able, at a Stroum lecture, to say it really was found and it proved transformative. Yeah?
One last question,
okay.
Thank you. Actually, you just, with your discussion of Louis Brandeis's daughter, led into something that you haven't really talked about, but I think relates to what you've been saying all along. That's demographics. If there's one thing that's been fairly stable since, say, 1950, it's been relatively stable. It's been numbers. I know, and you know, that how hard it is to count Jews, certainly in this country. But the fact is that, however you read it, the Jewish population numbers have been at best, I think you'd agree, maybe not, stagnant. No matter how vibrant the community, we've been shedding individuals, and some new ones have come in. Nonetheless, the numbers have been stagnant. And in absolute terms, just as some of our friends in the mainline Protestant groups, we seem to be having to resign ourselves to living in a much smaller room, no matter how vibrant our life is. Would you care to address the demographic?
Yeah, I mean, it's a different question, and I'm not a demographer. That, of course, won't prevent me from answering the question, but it's basically correct. There are many battles between the demographers, as you probably know. You can find demographers who will tell you that Jewish numbers have begun to fall. That would be the first decline since the colonial era. Otherwise, it has either risen or been stable, and they would argue that we declined from about 5.7 million to 5.2 million. And there are other demographers who say, nonsense, we've actually been growing. That has something to do, naturally, we're back to who is a Jew. It has something to do with who is a Jew. If you count everyone who lives with Jews to be part of an extended Jewish family, then of course the numbers have grown very greatly in recent years, although that's not generally the way we imagine the Jewish people to be. I'm among those who think it is not unlikely that Jewish numbers will fall in the United States. A community grows through immigration, and today Jewish immigration in the United States is virtually nil. It grows through conversion. There is some conversion, but it's not clear to me that the number in is more than the number that is lost. And it grows through a birth rate. And the birth rate of Jews is less than replacement level, as is true of all people of Jewish whites of similar socioeconomic status. Those are the only three ways I know that a community can grow, and we're not likely to see that kind of growth. The real interesting question when we look around the diaspora is why the decline wasn't greater. In England, you dropped much more significantly, shedding 100,000, it did shed about to at least 25%. And the diaspora as a whole has declined by about 0.8% a year, something like that. So my suspicion is there will be slow decline, and of course, since the American population is growing quite rapidly, even if the Jewish population remains static, we will be a smaller part of the whole, and that's been true for a long time. The Jewish community peaked at about 3.7% in the 1940s. Today, but don't tell people, Jews are less than 2% of the community. There isn't a one-to-one relationship between numbers and power in the United States. Indeed, we now have 3 Supreme Court justices who are Jewish. When we were at 3.7%, there was only one. There's no one-to-one relationship there. And there are no significant questions as to whether demography is destiny, as the Israeli scholars tend to argue, or whether a community is judged on its accomplishments and so on. In any case, I don't expect that we're going to see a massive baby boom in the American Jewish community. And indeed, even when you raise the issue, what you find is great resistance. Women baby factories, and so on. Only in Israel, of all of the places where Jews live, do we truly have a pronatalist society that believes, you know, we need to have more children. Milton Himmelfarb, the late Milton Himmelfarb, believed it and had 7 children, but he didn't have, wrote about it, but he didn't lead many to follow in his wake. So the bottom line of demography is that if this talk had been about demography, we probably wouldn't be very optimistic. But I do think that ultimately the future of the American Jewish community is not going to be decided in heaven and not even going to be decided demographically. It's going to be decided by American Jews, largely by young American Jews, by the graduates of this program, by people in this room. We're either going to shape the future badly, or we're going to shape the future well and creatively. I wish you the best of luck.